So let my love be the proof of your love. Let my love look like you and what you made.
We are in the book of Colossians, if you want to be turning there. The book of Colossians, and we're going to be covering chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. And I was going to try and attempt to cover much more, but as you know, the studies go, we find more and more information that need to pass on. So I thought, you know what, let me just cover four verses. And as most of you know, after we cover the passage, then we open it up for your questions and your comments. So if as I'm going through this passage and some questions come up, write them down or whatever, and then afterwards you can ask those questions or make those comments. So most of us know that, especially here in America, many, many, many are claiming to know God and to trust God and to go to church and so forth. Estimates are that 90% of Americans claim to believe on spiritual things, especially in the Christian faith. But the percentage of those living, listen to this, the percentage of those actually living by the spiritual realities, by the claims of Christ, is very, very low. And so we have to go back to that, right? We claim to be Christians. We claim to know God, but the way we actually live tells a different story. And that tells us that we really don't know a whole bunch about God himself. No, let me rephrase that. We don't know God personally. We might know a lot about him, but we don't know him personally. And the Apostle Paul in Colossians chapter 3 is constantly moving towards helping believers live according to the realities of the Christian faith. And, you know, we need to know God in a way that's very personal. Someone has said, look, we know a lot about God, and it's like this rope that's hanging from up there, and this rope comes down, and it's like on that rope it says, God's holiness, God's judgment, God's love, God's forgiveness. And this rope, it all says in that rope. And we need to hang on to that rope. If you're here on this stage and no, I'm going to stay in the stage. I'm going to be secure. But this is not life. You have to cling on to that rope. You pull on the rope and it says the love of God, the forgiveness of God. It says, you know all this information about God. But you don't depend on that rope. Then you will not feel, you will not experience God himself. Until you actually really live out by faith. Then you get to know him personally. Right? But to live that way, just one passage before we go to Colossians chapter 3. John chapter 14. John 14. And verse 21. He says, Jesus speaking to his disciples, he who has my commandments and keeps them is the one who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father. And I will love him and will disclose myself to him. This is the way we actually get to personally know God, not just have information about him. And by the way, that's why many people get discouraged, because they know the Bible, but they're not experiencing God. And so, the Christian life, you know what? Okay, I'll just behave because I'm supposed to, but, and what does it take? It takes to actually step forward by faith. I'm going to love in spite of the fact that I'm being mistreated. I'm going to give in spite of the fact that no one's given to me. By faith that God is really with me. By faith that God is really going to provide for me. And I move forward by faith and take those steps. That's the way to actually know God personally. It's just like that rope. If I really hang on to the rope and Geronimo, and it holds me, it's like, oh, the rope really holds me. I'm experiencing the strength of that rope. You see? And so it is to step forward by faith and trust God. And that is an ongoing, lifelong situation. That we're going to have to live by faith. The just shall live by faith. I lied. One more passage before we go to Colossians. Look, it's Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11. Starting in verse 8. Hebrews chapter 11, starting in verse 8. By faith, Abraham went when he was called, obeyed by going out to a place which he was to receive for an inheritance. And he went out, not knowing where he was going. God told him, leave your relatives, leave everything that you already know, all the streets, all the shops, everything, all your friends. No, you got to leave everything. And go to a place where I'm going to give you an inheritance. And Abraham, by faith, moved. Verse 9, by faith he lived as an alien in the land of promise, as in a foreign land, dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, fellow heirs of the same promise. Right? Of the same promise. And what was he looking for? Verse 10, for he was looking for the city which has foundations, whose architect and builder is God. There it is. He was looking for something in the future, something that God had built for him, and he's the architect. And we as Christians, what do we look forward to? For the second coming of Christ. And if we don't live by that, we don't experience God. We might know all the religious stuff. We might know all the answers. We might turn to the Bible and know where it is, but we don't know him that well. You see, we need to be living by faith in what God has said and who we are, what God has done already. I mean, Abraham didn't know. We know, right? We know. But it's by faith that we move forward. You don't want to live by faith? I don't want to live by faith? Guess what? God is going to be this distant, impersonal force out there somewhere. I know he exists, but I just in here, nothing. That's the way it's going to be, you see? And it's a challenge because it's an ongoing, all through life, that's the way it works, right? So Abraham, by faith, is a constant challenge by God to live in the realities of God's word and God's works. And it's up to us whether we all have to make that choice. And I have found out that I make that choice. I made that choice 40-some years ago. I made that choice 30-some years ago. I made that choice 25 years ago. I made that choice 15, 10, 5, 5 minutes ago. I had to make it. It's an ongoing choice to trust God, to move forward by faith. And things many times are not going to work out the way we want them to work. But by faith, we move forward and say, Lord, I don't know you well. I need you. I know you're real. But let me live by faith and obey by faith. Live accordingly. And most people are not living accordingly. And so the Apostle Paul was addressing that. And so before we go forward, I say, you know, where are you at this evening, this afternoon? Those of you that are watching, where are you? How does it show if you say, no, I'm living the Christian life. I want to live the Christian life. Well, how does it show? Does it show? Or is it just the right words to say? Are we conscious throughout the week that we represent God to others? Wow. Wow. Many, many have said what? You say something with your words, but your actions are more powerful, right? Actions speak louder than words. How, is it showing that we're living and trusting God? Does it show? I had a lady many, many, many years ago. She started coming and she wanted her relatives to come. But, and this has been repeated many, many times, by the way, what I'm about to tell you. She wanted her relatives to come. And they wouldn't. And she finally, why? Why won't you just join me? You know the response? Well, your life tells me that church is not helping you at all. Ah, you're not living the life that you say you want me to live. You want me, but your life shows me, like, why should I go? Oops. And we all have to ask that question about ourselves, right? Because then we can complain about the Christian life, but we ourselves are not really actually living it out by faith. How much energy do you spend on the physical things of the world versus the spiritual things? We spend all kinds of time. We're willing to watch 2 hours of basketball. 2 hours. Can we read 20 minutes of the Bible? 10 minutes? Can we spend 10 minutes praying? Oh, man, but the finals. Right? Woo! Here we go. You know, we're all guilty of that. We all are, right? So just relax. It's not that just to condemn you or nothing. No, it's just surfacing the realities. You see? And the Apostle Paul knew all this as well about his times and the people around him. Because when we don't live by faith, you know what we live by? We live, listen to this carefully. When we don't live by faith in trusting God, we live by religion. And the religion may not be going to church. The religion may not be praying and lighting candles and all this. No. The religion may be, I have to exercise. If I don't exercise, I have to do my whatever you're gifted in. What are you gifted in? And you just give yourself to that. You give to yourself. And I have to do it. I have to do it. Maybe your religion is, I got to protect myself and I'm not going to say anything. Zip. Nobody's going to know me. Period. And you work really hard at nobody knowing you. That's your religion. Religion is not necessarily just, like I said, going to church and praying and doing all these rituals. No, religion may be just the thing that you feel you have to do. That's your religion. And it doesn't work. It doesn't work. For millennia, we humans have tried. Religion everywhere. Right? Now, I'm using religion in a particular way. Religion, having a system of behaviors that win the approval of some higher power. That's religion. Some system of behaviors or works where I'm going to be accepted by whoever I think is the most powerful. Maybe it's your boyfriend. Maybe it's your spouse. Maybe it's a professor. Maybe it's an uncle, parent. Somebody, and you work hard at getting their approval, that's religion. Right? If religion is used as merely a means to, through Jesus Christ, that we connect with God, then that's appropriate. Right? But most of the time, religion is used in this way, that I'm going to do certain behaviors, and that's going to win acceptance before some higher power, be that God or be that some person or whatever. And so we all have certain religion, right? But it doesn't work. And that's what the Apostle Paul has been saying in the last section of Colossians chapter 2. Before we get into chapter 3, that's the context where Paul is saying, look, man, you have all these do's and don'ts. Don't taste, don't touch, don't do this. And some religions, you know, you got to really treat yourself rough. And you got to be on your knees and, you know, be on your knees for a half a mile. And then God's going to answer your prayer when you do that. Man. And you have religions of all kinds, right? Pray 5 times in one specific direction. You'll be okay. You do this certain times of the day or certain times of the week, and it's all religion. And Paul says it doesn't work. Sometimes it's pretty impressive. Sometimes it is very impressive. I remember going to Germany, and we were in this plane, and this guy had all this regalia, you know, in his head, and then all of a sudden he breaks out this leather strap, and he ties it real tight around his arm, and then he goes down and, whew, man, that guy's, man, he's probably next to God. Now, it's all religion. You see, religion. And the Apostle Paul, it can look very impressive. In Colossians chapter 2, verse 23, he says, these are matters which have to be sure, the appearance of wisdom in self-made religion, and self-abasement and severe treatment of the body, but are of no value against fleshly indulgence. They really don't work. That's what he's saying. So, what about us Christians? Well, the Apostle Paul is going back and saying, look, guys, look, guys, look. If you've trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ, you died with him and you were raised with him. You have this position, this awesome legal position in Christ. And you need to live according to that rather than by the old system of trying to make life work. And now that's what he starts now in chapter 3, starting in verse 1. Therefore, in other words, since religion doesn't work, and it'll never work, therefore, if you have been raised up with Christ, keep seeking the things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above and not on the things on the earth. For you have died, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. So much to say here, these few verses. I think verses 1 and 2 are saying, look, live by the position that you have in Christ. It's a done deal. Live accordingly. We're going to unpack that. Verses 3 and 4, I think living totally for the future, for the future that's totally secure. Live for the future. That future is so secure, but you need to live for that future. We're going to unpack that. What does that mean? And then we'll look at some applications. So we begin then in verse 1. Did you see that? If there's a certain condition there. And the Apostle Paul is basically saying, look, let's assume that this is true for the sake of argument. Let's say that you have believed in Jesus, that you have been raised with Christ. Let's just assume that is true for the sake of argument. Have you? And if you have, then if you have been raised with Christ, that is when you trusted in Jesus Christ, you were baptized with him into his death, and you were raised with him. And that means many, many things. In fact, go back to chapter 2, verse 11, 12, and 13. Paul is now in chapter 3. He's assuming, and he's what he already said in chapter 2, but let's see what that means, right? Chapter 2, verse 11. And in him, that is in Christ, you were also circumcised with a circumcision without hands, meaning this is a spiritual circumcision, in the removal of the body of the flesh. The body of the flesh is this weak, impotent, fallen human nature, right? And you have been, that's been taken away by the circumcision of Christ, having been buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through faith in the working of God. This is not of you. This is the work of God. You can't light 1,000 candles for this. You can't give money for this. You can't get baptized 1,000 times for this. You can't go to church 1,000,000 times for this. No, this is the work of God. You've got zero to do with that. Who raised him from the dead. And what does that mean? Verse 13. When you were dead in your transgressions, dead means you were separated from God, you're spiritually dead, and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he made you alive, meaning he reconnected you with God together with him, having forgiven us all our transgressions. So that's what it means. We are forgiven. We are made alive. We are reconnected with God. We have this position with God. We've been raised with him. So now in chapter 3, Paul says, let's assume that has happened. If you have been raised with Christ, keep seeking the things above. Keep seeking the things above. Where Christ is. Where is he? Seated at the right hand of God? What's important about that? Well, you go sit next to the owner of your business, next to the highest person in whoever, and then that person tells you, hey, you are second in power to all that I own and all my company. You sit at my right hand. Woohoo! Right? Jesus is sitting at the right hand of God Almighty, meaning he's got the position of power. And Paul is saying, you are seated with Christ. Wow. You have the position of Christ. 1,000,000,000 things come into play, right? You're seated next to the right hand of God in Christ Jesus. If that is the case, and let's assume that it is for the sake of argument, then shouldn't you be living for the things that Christ lives for? Shouldn't you be acting and living out the truth of the position you have with Christ? Come on, come on. And that's what Paul is trying to do with the Colossians. Hey, think, think. If you really are with Christ, then seek the things above. The character of Christ. What does he seek? Does he seek a Ferrari? Position in some company? What does he value? You see? What is he after? Just by way of summary, just by way of, and we'll talk more about this, Christ seeks love, righteousness, truth. Because he doesn't need anything. He's at the right hand of God Almighty. He doesn't need anything. So Paul is saying, think about it. If you're already next to Christ, you're sitting in the right with Christ. You've been raised with him. Think of the things above. Keep seeking the thing. And by the way, this is an ongoing thing as well. To keep thinking, What does Christ value? What gets Jesus angry? What makes Jesus happy? What makes him sad? What makes him sing? What does he value? It is an ongoing thing all the time, right? If I have a home, what would Jesus do with that home? Is it about me? Me, 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 me? Really? No. Let me use it to bring people. Let me use it to minister to people. You see? And it's an ongoing, keep seeking. It's an ongoing process. You can be 5 years old, 90 years old. You say, what would Christ do? What's Christ's values here? How would he respond? You see? Keep seeking the things above, where Christ seated at the right hand of God. You see? It's an ongoing thing. Keep learning. Keep growing. Keep learning. Keep growing about the character of Christ, the means, the way Christ does things. You see? And so now he says, he goes on. Now, set your mind on the things above. Now, he repeats it again, right? Of the things above. But now he has the negative. And not on the things of the earth. Notice, first he says, seek the things above, right? But now he says, set your mind. Use your mental energies for the things above. How many times in the day do I think about the things above? Most of the time I think about the things here on earth, right? And the Apostle Paul is saying, you're not living consistent with the position you have in Christ. You're not living a consistent life. It's no wonder your life is contorted and, what do I do? And here we go. And it messed up. Because it's not consistent with who you are, where I am. Is it any wonder that any little thing will get me angry and I want to kill somebody? Or I want to kill myself? Because we're all contorted inside. You see, we're not living consistently with what we say we believe, or with the reality of who we are in Christ. And so any little thing is going to throw me off. Any little thing is going to throw me off. I don't know why I'm angry all the time, but I'm furious. I'm enraged all the time. Well, it's right there. You see? Set your mind, your mental energies on things above, not on things that are on the earth. Verse 2, we can meditate like hours. Hours. Man, what do I spend most of my time? All my energies, my mental energies, I'm concerned whether I'm going to be liked or not, whether I'm going to be accepted or not, whether I'm going to succeed or not, with nothing to do with Christ and the things above. And that's why we need to come back to the Word of God to say, what does it say again? What's the meaning? Because you see, we're all insecure. We're very, very insecure. And so we have to go around protecting ourselves, right? And so now he says, you know, let's go back to the truth. Verse 3, for you have died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. What does that mean? Your life. Life. What is life? You know, because we're all scared that we're going to miss out. We're all scared we're going to miss out. Oh, look at them. Look at them. They have the latest iPod, the latest iPhone, the latest car, the latest, and we don't. Look at them. They're in Cancun. And I'm here in Far Texas. I leave it over there, 301 Flag Drive. Man, it's all hot and dry, and geez. And I'm going to miss out. Everybody's having fun, and I'm not. You see, and our thinking is way off. And the Apostle Paul said, your life, what really, really matters, is hid in Christ. It's absolutely, absolutely secure. You're not going to miss out, believe me. And we have to apply that by faith. Because the immediate is so attractive. So attractive. Man, a brand new pickup. Woo! Or whatever. It's so there. Now. And we think that is life. That's not life. You see? It's not life. It's the things of Christ. And he says now in verse 4, listen, your future is secure. Your future is absolutely secure. When Christ, who is our life, you see, is not the things of this earth. Christ is our life, our meaning, our significance, our security, our everything, our importance in life is Christ. You see, your life is hidden in Christ. And when he is revealed, who is our life, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. In glory, what really matters. Do we live by that? We say we believe in Christ for our life, right? But do we live for him? Or are we constantly trying to protect ourselves? So when he says, going back to verse 2, set your minds on things above and not things of earth. It's kind of like, look, you've already given the position. Let's say somebody gets hired as a manager. You get hired as a manager of some big business, and you've never worked there before. As far as a manager, you see all the other workers, and maybe you've been working as an entry-level worker. You've been given the position of manager. What do you need to do? You need to stop thinking of being an entry-level worker, and you need to start thinking, man, what does a manager do? What's the purpose of a manager? I got to act like a manager because I am a manager, right? It's the same what Paul is saying. You're in Christ Jesus. You're sitting at the right hand of God. Start living that way. And that means you start thinking about, you know, if you're the manager, okay, what's going to be successful for the company? Because that's the way I get paid. And that's the way if they're successful, I'm successful. So, and that's what it is with Christ. Start thinking in terms of the Christian life the way Christ thinks about it. And that's what he's saying. So how do we live this out? How do we live this out? Because you see, I think the Apostle Paul again is reminding the Christians that we need to be freely living for God. It's not a pressure. Now I have to. God doesn't want us to live out of pressure. What is that? That's a prison. That's pressure. I have to behave like a Christian. I have to. No. There needs to be a freedom to do that. A wanting to do that. You see? And how can we do that? Because of our position in Christ, that he delivered us from our sinful ways. All our sins have been paid for. So I am free now. I don't have to secure my own life. You see? And God is so good because look what he's done for me. That now I am free to really live for God out of freedom and desire. but we don't live like that, then we stay in prison. We stay in our religion, in our legalism. Things have to be done just so. No. So, my first application is this. We must be ever investigating what Jesus would like us to be going after. Well, what does Christ go after? It's what we need to be going after. You see? And it's a constant investigating of that. Now, some things are pretty clear. It's boom, they're right there. Like the golden eggs are right there just for a taking. So turn to 1 Timothy. Here's one of those places where it's just there. 1 Timothy chapter 6. 1 Timothy chapter 6. You're going to say, well, what does it mean to go to live the Christian life? What am I supposed to be going after? And when you find out what you're supposed to be going after, listen, you will have no more time for anything else. It's going to be your career like deflates. If you really, really live by what he's saying here, you're a man to live for that. Wow. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 11. The previous passage is about money. Money, 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 money. The love of money. Not money. The love of money gets people into all kinds of troubles. Right? All kinds of troubles. But, verse 11, but flee from these things, you man of God, and pursue, here it is. Here it is. Right there. You don't have to know Greek. You don't have to know Hebrew. It's right there. Look at it. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, perseverance, and gentleness. That's quite a list. You start living, you start seeking, pursuing after righteousness for the love of God, not out of pressure, not out of pressure. No, no, no. But because you love God. What does it mean to live righteously, godly, faith, love? Oh my goodness. Each one of those would take a long, long time. Right? And Paul is saying, put your mind on those things. You see? Instead of worrying so much about what the world is offering or you're missing out on. Those things are, you're to be dead to those things. Christ delivered you from that, those lies from Satan. You're free now to live for God. But it takes this ongoing investigation. What did all that mean to live in love and faith and righteousness and godliness? Wow, wow, wow. And the Apostle Paul said, that's the way to freedom. That's the way to freedom. And having clear eyes in life. Have clarity of thinking. You see? So we must be ever investigating what Jesus goes after and what we're to be going after. That's really the application of verse 1 of Colossians chapter 1, verse 3. In verse 2 of Colossians 3, the Apostle Paul says, not on the things of the earth. We must say no. We must say no when we begin to think and be worried about the things of this earth. When you begin to see yourself as, I'm worried about this, and I'm not going to do this, and I'm not going to get that, I'm not going to achieve that. It's like, stop worrying about those things. Now, it's not as though we just sit around and do nothing. No, that's not the point. We're still to be responsible. If you're going to school, you're supposed to be really getting A's and B's, if not all A's. Okay, relax. Some C's. You're like, oh, I'm going to get A's. Oh, A's all the time. Pressure, pressure. Stop it. But be a good student. Yeah. But listen, those are secondary things. Are you living righteously? Are you living in love? Are you having faith in God? Or are you all worried, tied up in knots, you're neurotic about everything? Or enraged about everything? Stop saying no. When you begin to think and be worried about the things of the earth, you see. And And that's really two sides of the coin, right? One side you look at, what am I worried about of the things of the world? God forgive me. God forgive me. These idols. They're idols. God forgive me. And the other side of the coin is, Lord, I want to trust you. By faith, I'm going to start saying no to the things of the earth and start saying yes to the things of Christ, the things above, right? And so we must say no when we begin to think and worry about the things on the earth. My last application, which is verse 4 of Colossians chapter 3, when Christ, who is our life, is revealed. What are you talking about? When Christ returns. When Christ returns. You see? Let's live for the coming heavenly recognition. Heavenly recognition. Because you see, we're totally secure in Christ. We are totally secure in Christ. We don't have to be worrying whether I'm going to miss out or not miss out, whether I'm going to be recognized as, ooh, what a great person, or all this. Stop. When Christ returns, that's when we're going. Did you live for him or not? And if you did, Jesus Christ in front of all the angels of heaven, in front of God, well done, good and faithful servant. Wow. 1,000 Olympic medals will never, ever compete with Jesus' words of eternity. And that's just the very foundation. Then you have other people that are going to be appreciating you when you lived for Christ, when you helped them live for him. You spoke the gospel to them. Luke chapter 16. I mean, those are the living for the things of God, you see. In Matthew 16, verse 23, I'll end with this. Matthew 16, verse 23, says this. But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are a stumbling block to me. For you are not setting your mind on the God's interest, but man's interest." Then Jesus said to his disciples, "If anyone wishes to come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever wishes to save his life," and you save your life by going for the things of this world. You're trying to save your life by going after the things of this world. "Will lose it." Doesn't work. "But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his soul? Or what will the man give in exchange for his soul? For the Son of Man is going to come in his glory of his Father and his angels, and will repay every man according to his deeds." Did you live for Christ or not? You see. And we'll have to make that choice. And the Apostle Paul is saying, look, I know you're just like all other human beings. You're tempted to live for this world. You don't want to, you're not living for Christ. You really don't know him that well. But I'm inviting you, I'm stimulating you to let go. And start living for Christ, for the things above. Because everything else is not real life. And if you think you found life, you're going to lose it. But if you live for Christ, you're going to get the real life. But it's up to you. Then you will have the real freedom to live for God. Really live for him. And not be so worried about this life. So let my love be